Jacques de Jong, and I am asked to talk a little bit about restructuring the EU energy industry. It is my pleasure to do that in the context of the Florence School of Regulation. What I would like to do is, after a short introduction, to say a few words about the EU framework with respect to the internal energy market that has been built on and as it more or less exists today. And then finally, I will say a few words about the new challenges that the EU energy industry is facing. As an introductory remark, it is necessary to understand that from moving from a monopolistic system into a liberalized market setting, a number of steps have been made in the past, moving from a vertically integrated monopoly into a development where maybe a single buyer has been accomplished, where wholesale competition has been increased, and finally also retail competition is established, is implemented, and is now today in a process of development. This does not mean to say that within the EU as a whole, this whole development took place in all member states by the same time. Some member states went faster than other member states, and this is also something to take into account. In addition, it is useful to underline that the whole discussion about liberalization, about privatization, about regulation or deregulation, or maybe even re-regulation, is loaded with different terminologies that are not always interpreted in the same way, that have sometimes led to confusion. And it is necessary to be aware of that and to be a little bit more precise when you are talking about privatization, that you do not mean liberalization or vice versa. The drivers that we had, and now I am coming to the second chapter of my introduction, the drivers that we had in the EU for energy market liberalization are not drivers from the last couple of years, but they started already in the 1980s with this drive to introduce more market forces and to limit the role of governments. And in the discussion that to quite some political extent came from the Reagan administration on the US side, crossing the Atlantic to the United Kingdom, the Thatcher government was very instrumental to bring this further in the European context, and Jacques Delors in his days started this whole process of finalizing an internal market, creating market liberalization, not only for all sorts of non-utility sectors, but also for the utility sector at large. Now, in the EU, the model that we have established together is based on the so-called third package after directives on that in 96 and 98 and in 2003. We now have a set of directives from 2009 where the issues like mandatory market opening, efficient and adequate consumer protection, the unbundling of the transmission networks, and also the legal unbundling of the distribution networks went hand in hand with the introduction of regulated third-party access. And that required also the establishment of regulatory commissions, regulatory authorities in all the 27 member states of the European Union. These directives have to be implemented nationally in national legislation. And it is the task of the European Commission to oversee the compliance at national levels of these EU-wide directives that have been accomplished and that have been set. In addition to those directives, both for gas and for electricity, we have three separate regulations that gives the Commission the mandate to control and to implement that, that goes further than the national levels. Regulations for cross-border electricity trade, for gas grids, access to gas grids, and a separate regulation for the establishment of ACER, the Agency for the Cooperation of the National Energy Regulators. Underlining again, very precisely, that the core of the European model is unbundling the networks in order to secure non-discriminatory third-party access. And that unbundling, especially for the transmission system operators, could be done via three options: full ownership unbundling, or the possibility of the establishment of an independent system operator, and as a third option, the independent transmission operator. These options were the subject of very heavy and complicated negotiations during the time that the third package was created and was finally established. And as a critical note from my side, I would like to underline that especially the option of the independent transmission operator is a further refinement of the already established legal unbundling of the TSO as it occurred in the second package. And I myself would consider this ITO option not as a very useful option, because it would create additional burdens for national regulatory authorities. ACER, as the agency that is established for the cooperation of the national regulators, has a focus on cross-border issues, assessing, advising, supervising, recommending, conflict settlement in cross-border access cases. These are the tasks of ACER. And this is very positive that the ACER regulation creates this instrument, creates this institution. But again, my critical notes on that are also that there are not always clear mandates for ACER in setting the codes, in setting the network codes, in taking legally binding decisions, and also the governance of the decision-making process in ACER is not the most effective and efficient one in a 27 board that one could think of. Another feature of the third package is the creation of the ENTSOs, the European Networks for TSOs for gas and for electricity, bringing those parties fully in line with the institutional theater that the European Union has created. And the two ENTSOs for gas and for electricity have two major tasks. The first task is to develop a system of binding network codes, and the other task is to come with indicative 10-year planning projects for the development of new energy infrastructures. And this last task also requires an important European vision on the future developments of the energy market. The codes, binding as they will be, are based on a rather complicated process where framework guidelines are set by ACER as a guideline for the ENTSOs to come with more specific proposals for the network codes themselves. And in the final case, the Commission will take the binding decision after having consulted via the comitology process with the member states. The planning of the guidelines and the codes for gas and electricity has been set in order to finalize the whole process by 2014-2015. Very ambitious, very straightforward, and very bullish in order to move in that direction. And there is a lot of effort put by all stakeholders, by all authorities, in order to meet those timelines and to more or less finalize the completion of the internal market for gas and the internal market for electricity. Moving to further challenges. Challenges that are still exist in the sense of integrating cross-border markets and further developing wholesale markets, bringing new infrastructures also online, amongst others, in order to meet the huge and ambitious challenges that have been put into the roadmap, the energy roadmap for 2050. Now, ongoing restructuring of the TSOs plays a role in that respect, especially when it comes to crossing borders. And this development is not yet finalized. It is still ongoing, where the roles of the ENSOs also might become more important. And as some would say, this may be also the way towards an EU-wide independent system operator, maybe step by step, starting at regional levels, but also evolving from further cross-border ownerships and cross-border structural changes that are taking place in the world of the TSOs. And this is necessary in order to bring further forward the integration of wholesale markets, where we see already today a further coupling of electricity markets, where we see already a further development of price convergences, bringing also a good role for power exchanges on the two sides of the borders. And on this slide, you can see in the map that this process is further evolving. And especially in electricity, I must say, this goes very well. Whereas for gas, it is still a difficulty. It is somewhat lagging behind, and there are still a number of uncertainties about the further design of the European internal gas market, to what extent hubs are playing a role, and to what extent the entry-exit tariffication zones for transmission have to be evolving, whereas every member state has the task to implement this system of entry-exit zoning. But it is not yet quite clear to what extent this will have an impact on the further development of the internal EU gas market. New investments in infrastructure are also very much needed in order to meet the bold objectives for the further development of renewable electricity sources, renewable energy sources like wind and solar power. Investments also needed for further enhancing market integration, building further interconnection in the system, also for increasing system adequacy, securing also supply, security of supply, for instance, in gas, playing a role. In order to meet those challenges, the Commission has put on the table a proposal for a directive, a regulation, not a directive, a regulation for infrastructure that would bring new instruments for enhancing a speedy implementation, a speedy permitting process for new infrastructure projects, also the possibility including for coming with specific approaches for how to regulate and how to give the right incentives to investors to come forward in bringing those projects to a good end. The planning of the ENSOs for gas and for electricity for their next 10 years or so that are being put forward require a large sum of investments, some 200 billion euros, with about a 50-50 split between gas and electricity, and a very useful tool for further debate and specific decision making. I mentioned security of supply for gas, not only enhancing further internal supply security by addressing the issue of internal solidarity as a result of the supply interruptions that we had the last couple of years, but also allowing more flows from the west to the east in addition to the existing gas flows from the east to the west, bringing new supplies from outside the EU, for instance, via the southern gas corridor, is also in this context to be mentioned and is a point that remains high on agendas, especially when we are moving forward in a post-2020 period up to 2050, where again, as I said, bullish targets are to be set, are to be discussed in an energy roadmap where the role of electricity will be further enhanced, where energy efficiency and more renewables and more networks and more crossing border flows, crossing border networks, crossing border approaches are necessary. Regional grid potentials are one of the results that further have to be looked at, not only around and through the Mediterranean basin, bringing, for instance, large amounts of solar power generated in Northern Africa to European markets, but also when it comes to wind energy, offshore wind energy in the areas around the North Sea, the Northern Sea, also asking for innovative designs of complex network configurations. All these elements are playing a role and are on agendas for policy makers. And I thank you very much for your attention, and I hope that this short talk has helped you a little bit about learning what is accomplished and what is foreseen, what is a new challenge. Lots of work still have to be done. Thank you very much.